Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for blowing in for this afternoon's event to spend some time alongside the multi-talented Hermitage alum, Stephen Cole. My name's Bryn Durgan, and I'm Director of Programming here at Bookstore One. I know I see some new faces tonight, so I will let you know, of course, we sell books, but we also have a ton of programming. So we do author events like we're doing this afternoon, and writing workshops, and book signings, and live radio theater events, and a lot of it wouldn't be possible if it weren't for our customers like you. So thank you so much. It does mean the world to us. And another big thanks to the Hermitage Artist Retreat for partnering with us. They host some of the most influential and culturally consequential artists of our time, and we're so lucky to be able to team up with them whenever we can. So now I'm going to pass it off to James, the program manager of the Hermitage Artist Retreat, to tell you a bit more about Stephen Cole and the Hermitage as well.
Thanks, Bryn. I'm just going to brag for a second on Stephen Cole, who is returning back to the Hermitage. He's a returning fellow, and we're super excited to have him. But before we get to that, I want to reciprocate how excited we are to be here at Bookstore One. We were just chatting about how a beautiful space it is. I can't imagine a better spot to enjoy a book and find a new book to enjoy. So we're always happy to be here and love these intimate conversations up here in this loft space. As Bryn said, the Hermitage down on Minnesota Key, surviving the weather as we speak, is a multidisciplinary artist retreat. So in addition to literature, which you'll hear a little bit about tonight, some of our artists do multiple disciplines, right? So if you enjoy what you're hearing this evening, I hope you'll join us on Friday, where Stephen and collaborator David will present a little bit more about Ethel Merman with the musical Merman's Apprentice. We're expecting a pretty good turnout down on the beach, all pending weather, of course. But you'll hear a couple of numbers from that, and we're joined by our partners at Venice Theater to present that. But very excited to be here. Let me brag on Stephen for a second. He is an award-winning musical theater writer whose shows have been recorded, published, and produced in New York City, London, the Middle East, Edinburgh, Scotland. He's the writer of many award-winning musicals and plays, such as The Night of the Hunter at the Goodman, Casper with Cheetah Rivera, and The Road to Cutter. In 2014, Cole wrote and directed Inventing Mary Martin. You might be sensing a theme, which we'll explore this evening, which played off-Broadway. Other produced shows include two family musicals, such as Merlin's Apprentice, don't get it twisted, and Rock Odyssey. And Rock Odyssey has been annually produced the last 10 years. Cole is also a published author with 4 books to his credit, including that book about that girl, And I Could Have Sung All Night, and the autobiography of the late Marnie Nixon and Noel Coward, and the memoir Put on a Happy Face. So, would you join me, please, in welcoming Mr. Stephen Cole.
Yay. Well, thank you. You know, we, let me turn this on. Okay, we like to call The Road to Qatar. When we first, I wrote that show with David Crane, and it was based on our incredible experience of writing the first American musical to premiere in the Middle East. And it was so insane that we wrote a show about it. And in those days, they did call it Qatar. Only the news people call it Qatar now. But it's much more pertinent today than it ever was before. It is probably, next to Mel Brooks, the most un-PC musical you've ever seen. So that's the road to Qatar. So Ethel Merman and Mary Martin, you know, why this book. And I originally started writing this book, and I originally called it Sacred Monsters. I thought that was a good name, that they were both sacred monsters. Somebody said, oh, we don't like them being monsters. And then I called it Freak Show, which was even worse. But I thought of, I really do believe that Broadway has lost that thing of, and I call them freaks in a just a wonderful way, the Carol Channings, the Ethel Mermans, the Mary Martins, the originals, the people that you can't put in a cookie cutter. And I grew up loving those people. So Freak Show, but anyway, the publisher said, oh, no. And he came up with this wonderful title, Mary and Ethel and Mikey Who. Of course, Ethel always likes to call it Ethel and Mary and Mikey Who. But Mikey Who was the big key to this whole thing, because this is a historical time travel coming of age novel. But it's the time travel thing that really intrigued me. Mikey is Mikey Marvin Minkus, a young man from Brooklyn, New York, who has more hair than me. And it's the show starts to take, the show, it's not a show yet, it's a book, and it takes place, it begins in 1983, when his mother comes downstairs to where he is living in her basement, and tells him that she is reading the National Enquirer, and she sees that Ethel Merman is felled by a brain tumor. And he goes, he's the biggest fan in the world, he gets on the subway and he goes to visit her. And that's how this book starts. And he goes to visit her, somehow gets in her apartment. Mary Martin happens to be visiting the ailing Ethel Merman. And at one point, Mikey is roaming around the apartment while Mary is talking to Ethel in another room. He hasn't even seen her yet. And he wanders into her closet. And he starts to look at an old Tony Award and an old Golden Globe. And the closet door shuts. And he winds up at the other end. And he pushes through a door. And he comes out in the dressing room of the Imperial Theater in 1939. And Sophie Tucker greets him. And so that goes through time from then on. It's a magical time travel piece. And so I thought, before we do anything, I want to show you Ethel and Mary. So this is from the cover of the book is a colorized version of what went on in 1953. Ethel and Mary had been Broadway stars. Mary had just done South Pacific. Ethel had just done Call Me Madam and Annie Get Your Gun. They were the biggest stars on Broadway. Sure. They had never worked together. They knew each other. They had been friends. They started to become frenemies. And at this point, a producer named Leland Hayward had an idea to do this. He was doing this huge TV show that was not only going to be on all three networks in those days, ABC, NBC, and CBS, but the Dumont Channel. Who remembers the Dumont Channel? No, yeah, it was, yes. So all four networks were going to have this. And so he called up Ethel and he said, listen, Ethel, I want you to be on the show. You're going to be the star. And wouldn't it be fun if you sang something with Mary Martin? She already said she's dying to do it with you. Ethel said, well, that sounds interesting. He called up Mary Martin and said, Mary, you're going to be the star of the show. And would you sing something with Ethel Merman? She's been begging you. Okay, fine. And he got them both together. And it was the first time that this duet was ever done. So I want to show you a good piece of this duet. It starts off with Ethel singing her signature song, I Got Rhythm. Hit it. Yeah. Aren't they amazing?
Amazing.
So let me tell you about that whole thing. You'll notice that Ethel Merman hardly ever looks at Mary Martin. That was her thing. She did it straight out. And Mary looks at her with such love. It's such an interesting, I wrote about that in the book too. The show was directed by Jerome Robbins. And I have to, we have musicians in the house, so I always have to give credit to Jay Blackton wrote that medley. And that's only half of the medley. There's a whole section of I songs. It was such a big deal that they put out a Decca record of the whole thing, a little 10-inch record that's still in existence today on CD. So my history with this is interesting. When I was very young, I knew Ethel Merman. I was friends with her. I always say, well, I was 10 and she was 76, well, but I was 20. And I met her because I knew her manager who did her concert. She did all these symphony concerts all over the country. And He used to come to my house, and I had these rare videos like this, but even rarer, and I would show him these tapes. And a year went by, and Ethel was going to appear at Carnegie Hall, and I went to see her, and he took me backstage, and she said to me, "I'm coming to your house." And the next week, she brought her son and came to my house to watch all these rare videos. She had a great time. She talked about it on an early morning talk show the next day, and we became friends. And for the next 2 years, the last 2 years of her life, she brought over all her friends to my house, and I would show the videos, and she would sit there and she would watch herself and say, "You see me up there? That's 1966, and I wasn't wearing a bra." She said, "If I did that now, they would all hit the floor." And that was Ethel. She was bawdy. She was a regular gal from Queens, New York. And one of my favorite moments was, it was a blizzardy day in New York, and we've had some of those in those days, and I went to visit her. She lived at the Surrey Hotel, and I was covered over in snow, and she opened up her door, and she looked at me, and she went, "The snow is snowing, the wind is blowing," and I thought, she's singing to me. Yeah, it was the most wonderful moment that I had. So when she died, I wrote a short story about a little girl named Uriel Plackenstein from Brooklyn, New York, who met her in 1970 and became Merman's apprentice. And I remember giving the story to David Evans, who's back there, the composer I'm working with at the Hermitage, and he said, "Hey, this would make a good musical." And I said, "Oh, you're just a big Ethel Merman fan." And he wasn't at all. And it was me. And so we started working on it, and we did a concert at Birdland. We did a second concert at Birdland in New York. We did a CD. It was premiered in Sonoma, California, and won an award for best score, which I always think includes lyrics, doesn't it? I don't know. I put it on my wall anyway. And we're looking to get that show on again somewhere else, as you're always doing. You have all these children, you're hoping you can get it on again. So I thought I had Ethel Merman out of my mind after Merman's Apprentice, but I also did an off-Broadway show, as he mentioned, called Inventing Mary Martin for her 100th birthday. That was a review with four people in it that played off-Broadway for her 100th birthday, and her daughter came, her grandchildren came. You know, Larry Hagman was one of her children, her son. He was gone then. Right. But Larry's two children came, the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren, and they didn't even know what a great star she was. It was such a wonderful experience to expose the great Mary Martin to her own family and of New York. So once again, I thought, well, all right, you've gotten Mary out of your system, you've gotten Ethel out of your system. And one day I thought, I need to write some fiction. I've been writing short stories, they've been winning awards. And I thought about them again. I said, maybe once and for all, I can get this out of my system. And I started to write this story. And Mikey came into it, Mikey Marvin Minkus, who propelled me into the book. I want to read to you from a chapter. So now that you know a little bit about the story, he's now gone back to 1939. And that happens to be the night that Mary Martin is singing "My Heart Belongs to Daddy" on Broadway for the last time. Because she's been in the show for a year and she's about to go out to Hollywood and become a movie star. Did you know she was a movie star? She made 14 movies and none of them were big hits. So she went back to Broadway. But anyway, this was the night, and it was also the night, in my imagination, that Ethel Merman met her. And I created the scene where Ethel Merman goes to see Mary Martin for the first time, sitting with Cole Porter, and sitting next to them is Mikey Marvin Minkus. So after the show, they all go out to the Rainbow Room. So let me see if I can read some of this. Okay. Mikey had never been to the Rainbow Room before, or any room remotely like it. Brooklyn boys who lived in the basement of their mother's home seldom saw anything like the plum-covered, plush Art Deco walls framing a carpeted revolving dance floor, surrounded by tiers of elegantly set tables and banquettes facing floor-to-ceiling windows with modernistic electric shades, also in deep plum, that when activated, opened to reveal 360-degree view of a magical metropolis only told of in books. Mikey had, of course, been to the Radio City Music Hall, taken by his mother Rivka as a tot, just a block up from this fairy tale tower, so he had an idea of its plush splendor. Between the movie and stage show, Mikey would exit the 5,000-seat auditorium and enter the majestic lobby where he could imagine living in the Palace of Dreams, walking down the grand staircase underneath the magnificent chandeliers, and then entering a men's room that he would gladly trade for his basement apartment, if only he could. Oh, Mr. John D. Rockefeller sure must have wanted the peasants to have a great day of fantasy for popular prices, thought Mikey. But if the music hall was Rockefeller's gift to the hoi polloi, the Rainbow Room was his grand bequest to the upper crust, who could afford more than dreams, those who could afford to dance in the clouds among the stars. Of all her companions that night, Mary Martin was most at home in the not-quite-five-year-old Rainbow Room. She had, after all, moonlighted after performances of her show for months at a time. And now, on the bandstand was her conductor, Eddie Duchin, the very same Duchin who had accompanied her on her hit recording of My Heart Belongs to Daddy. Now, as they exited the elevator and walked through the gallery, guarded on the east end by the stately maitre d', the two elegantly appointed staircases down into the Rainbow Room loomed before them. "So," asked Ethel in her usual no-nonsense way, "who goes in first?" "Why, Ethel," Mary responded in her unusually innocent honeysuckle tones, "you're the biggest star. You should go in first." "Well, yes, but if I go in first and the band plays I Got Rhythm, the crowd's gonna give me a nice hand." "Of course they will." "Yeah, but then when you come in and Duchin strikes up your daddy tune, they're gonna scream and jump out of their seats. So you go in first." "I don't see why they wouldn't play I Get a Kick Out of You," murmured Cole Porter under his breath. "That's a ballad, Cole, and ballads ain't good for entrance music. So, Mary and your filthy tune goes first." "Oh, I think I have to use the ladies' room. I'll meet you all inside," cooed Mary. "Oh, no, you don't. I'm not falling for that trick. I invented it back in 1930. Just ask Ginger Rogers. And anyway, I need to hit the loo, too." Neither Mary nor Ethel budged. Mikey was amused by this unsubtle game of Mexican standoff, Broadway style. "Since there are two staircases, why not walk in together?" Mikey reasonably suggested. Both ladies whipped around to look at him. Neither smiled, but four eyebrows were raised. Mikey went on. "Ethel will look like the magnanimous star giving the new toast of the town a loving send-off to Hollywood, and Mary will seem respectful to a more established Broadway luminary. Everybody wins." Ethel looked at Mary, and Mary looked right back at her. "But what music will they play?" Cole, who had been seated through the whole debate, perked up. "I have just the song. I just finished it. In fact, it's going to be the 11 o'clock spot for Bert Lahr and whoever gets to play Madame Du Barry." With that, Cole pulled from his lapel pocket a folded piece of manuscript paper with some chicken scratch scrawls penned in ink. He handed it to Mikey. "Hand this to Duchin and tell him to fill in the chords and give it a hillbilly swing." Mikey read the lyric aloud. "If you're ever in a," he stumbled when he could not read the next word. "Jab?" "Jam," Porter corrected. "Here I am. If you're ever in a mess, SOS. Hey, I know this song." "You can't know it. I just wrote it in the limo while waiting for all of you to exit the Imperial. Mikey called himself. I mean, I know the song is going to be known by everyone, a showstopper and a classic. I like this boy. What's the song called, Cole? Merman inquired. Friendship, just friendship. What could be more perfect for your dual entrance, offered Mikey. Mary thought for a second. Friendship, all right. All right, Ethel agreed. The lady shook on it. Cole rolled his eyes. But I still have to tinkle, Mary said. What the hell does that mean? Cole rolled his eyes again. Pee, Ethel. The child has to pee. Why the hell didn't you say so? Come on. I'm not letting you out of my sight. As the two musical comedy divas linked arms and headed back down the hall, past the elevator banks to the lavish rainbow room John, Ethel could be heard to inquire, so, when do you leave for Hollywood? Tuesday. Let me know if you need any help packing. That is an idea of their, as the years go by, they do become frenemies, but Mikey is the one who facilitates that. He becomes a press agent. He comes up with the idea of the famous feud when Ethel would say things like, yeah, Mary Martin's okay if you like talent, that kind of stuff. And it helps their careers go on, but they lose their real friendship along the way. So anyway, the book, as I said, the publisher, I tried to get it to other publishers. This publisher is a guy who published a wonderful book by a Broadway piano player, actually, Paul Ford, called, what's it called?
Lord Knows At Least I Was
There. Lord Knows At Least I Was There. And once I saw this book and how well it was doing and how well he was, I said, I want you to do my book. And he had never done fiction, so here it is now from More Clack Press. And let me, before I read any more of this, I want to read the back of the book, because this is my favorite part. It's all of the reviews. but it's advanced praise, as we call it. Stephen Cole has written a most disarming and fantastical dream of a story. Having worked with these two great stars and admired them both immensely, I am delighted that this novel gave them life again. Did I say I loved it? I loved it. Donna McKechnie, star of Chorus Line, Tony winner. And here's another, a wild, funny, and touching fantasy involving two of Broadway's most famous legends and their completely besotted fan, John Kander, the great Kander and Ebb. And here's one of my favorites, because this guy, you may know and you may not know Charles Bush, a wonderful playwright and a writer, and he has also his memoirs are out. You probably have it downstairs. But he and I did summer stock together when I was 14 years old. Mm-hmm. And I always knew him as Chuck, and he knew me as Steve Mitchell. We'll talk about that. But he wrote, both poignant and fiendishly funny, the author melds the stories of the legendary Ethel Merman and Mary Martin with that of his dazed but adoring fictional protagonist. Behind all the funhouse mirrors, we are always firmly guided by the sure hand of a first-rate theater and film historian. Thank you, Chuck Bush. So anyway, I would love to have some questions, actually.
Tell me about Mikey.
So Mikey was invented because I had a friend, a novelist friend, who David knew also. Her name was Rita Lakin. And Rita Lakin and I wrote a show called Grossingers together, which became Saturday Night at Grossingers. And she was a novelist who wrote a bunch of murder mysteries. The first one was called Getting Old is Murder. And it was about old people in Florida solving murders. And it's a great series. And when I went to visit Rita, and I showed her what I was grappling with the Mary and Ethel stuff, she said, you gotta put yourself into this. We've gotta have a character. And he is the ultimate theater nerd. His problem is that he lives downstairs in his mother's basement near the Maytag washing machine. And he is nothing but playing the records of Ethel and Mary. And his mother keeps telling him, go out and get a job. And so this whole journey is his coming of age, really. And the best part that I came up with was when he got to 1970, he got to meet himself as a young boy and meet his parents, and he gets to solve some things. Wouldn't we all love to go back to our childhood and help them out? And he does that. So that's, And I had a wonderful time. I worked with a wonderful actress named Barbara Minkus, who starred in Gross Singers, and so I named him after her. My brother's name is Marvin, and so he got in there too. So he keeps changing throughout the book, from Mikey to Michael to Mike to, you know, and Marvin. The name keeps evolving as he grows up. And he finally, at the end of the book, does grow up when he comes back through the other end of the closet, back to 1983. And gets to witness something really wonderful. But before I read about that, anybody else have any thoughts or questions or, yes?
Her eyes are so expressive.
Merman's eyes.
Yes.
Yes, she loved doing that. You have to remember, these people, like Ethel and Mary, were playing to big 1,500 seat houses, and they were playing to the balcony. And that's one of the reasons why Merman didn't look at the person next to her. There were no microphones then. And she just did it right out and right up to that balcony. And so the eyes and the expression, and also she was a very good low comedian. She was funny. And she knew how to do that. Even when Ethel's singing counterpoint with her, and Mary, she looks over at Mary like, what the hell are you singing? Did you have something to ask?
Yeah. As somebody who's only ever experienced this through a screen, I was wondering if you could just articulate what makes the talent so unique of these two incredible performers.
It is incredible. It's an era that's really gone. I mean, Merman debuted in 1930. She was 22 years old. When I knew her, she told me I was 18. They lied. She was 22. And she came out on the stage. Ginger Rogers was the star of the show. And it was called Girl Crazy by the Gershwins. And Merman's first song was a little ditty called Sam and Delilah, which stopped the show. 4 minutes later, she had a second song, and that was I Got Rhythm. And when she opened up that mouth and held the note for 16 bars as the band played, she came off stage. It was the end of Act One, and George Gershwin went up and climbed 5 flights to her dressing room at the Alvin Theater, which is now the Neil Simon. And he said, Ethel, do you know what happened out there? And she said, I thought my dress fell off. They were cheering so much. And he said, no, you've just become a star. And he gave, I had one piece of advice. He said, never go near a singing teacher. And she never did. She just had this natural sound. And to me, Merman was the first. In the 1920s, ingenues, female characters in shows, all sang soprano. They're because they had to get their voice over the orchestra without microphones. And it was all, and then came along this voice that had, and Mary Martin did say, why, Ethel, you're a tenor. She had this tenor ping to it, and it just went over the orchestra. And it was that excitement, and it was that urban quality that people hadn't seen in Broadway shows, that kind of, I know what I'm doing thing, and she did it. And she had no nerves, nerves of steel. She used to say, you know, I'm not nervous, why should I be nervous? They paid 50 cents a piece, they should be nervous. And so she just did it. And she had that great control and great comedy. As far as Mary, she came along in 1938, out of nowhere. She was from Weatherford, Texas. She had already been a wife and a mother. Her first son was Larry Hagman. And she divorced her husband, left Larry with her parents in Weatherford, moved to Hollywood to become a movie star. It wasn't working out in Hollywood. And so some Broadway producer had her audition for Cole Porter for a role in the show called Leave It to Me, and she sang My Heart Belongs to Daddy. I mean, it's almost the luck of the draw when you think about these debut songs and these debut people to do that. And she, the song's pretty dirty, My Heart Belongs to Daddy, where I think maybe we want to click this. Can we?
People, I don't know.
We've seen our clicker has left. Let's see if we can get to that. If you can go to, not that, but menu or something.
Yeah.
Let's see. 1 second. Because you might as well see a little of this. Well, you can. Maybe not.
No.
I'll see you later. So Cole Porter wrote what was really a very risque song. And it's, you know, while tearing golf, a game of golf, I may make a play for the caddy, but if I do, I don't follow through, 'cause my heart belongs to daddy. And Mary didn't really know at that age what she was even singing about. And so Sophie Tucker, who was in the show, the great big Sophie Tucker, she said to her, Mary, every time you don't know what you're singing about, put your eyes up to heaven and they'll think it's funny. And they did. And she also did a mock striptease in that show. But that made her, they each had these great debuts. But they were different, they were special, and they were both very different than each other. When Merman did Annie Get Your Gun, and I have a whole section of that in here, Mary Martin was jealous as could be. She thought, this is my role, I'm from Texas. And so she wound up doing the national tour of the show. And Merman came to see her do a gypsy run-through of the national tour and was knocked out by her and saw, this is somebody who could be my rival, I better be careful. And that show got her South Pacific. And then, of course, she was the original Maria in The Sound of Music. And amazingly, playing a 20-year-old postulant at 54 years old. So she was amazing. And also her husband, who's a big part of this book, Richard Halliday, was her husband/manager. And he took care of, he was the president of Mary Martin, Inc. Everybody should be lucky enough to have a husband who takes care of all your business and let her go on stage and be brilliant. So that's kind of how those ladies happen. But I always think it's the era of no microphones, it's the era of having to project it out there and giving your love. And Mary said that, she said about said this about sex. She doesn't care so much about sex. She says, I'm giving all my lust to that audience. They're the ones I'm giving to. I have no time for the rest of the world. It's just the audience. And they loved her. And with Merman, they saw somebody up there who was kind of just like them. Some, you know, she was a liberated dame before there were liberated dames. So that's kind of my explanation of that.
Thank you.
We were going to just take a look at Mary Martin, but don't worry about it. Let's not. No, I'd rather go. I want to go to the end here. So at the end of the novel, when he comes out of the closet, as it were, and he comes back in 1983. Let me see where I am. He finally gets to see Ethel as she was. So let's see. And the chapter is called First You Get Me High, Then You Get Me Low. And that is because that was a song that Ethel sang. Okay, so here he is, and he's about to finally meet his idol, who he's met over the years, but never as the adult Mikey. So, Mary says, she wants to see you. Mikey was scared. He had rushed here to see Ethel Merman, the star of stars, to save her from death, or at least to comfort her. But now, after journeying back and getting to really know his idol as a human being, he was frightened to see the woman behind that door, what she had become. He looked first at Mary, who understood his trepidation. Her face was encouraging and sympathetic. Would you like me to go in with you? Mary Martin asked. Yes, replied Mikey. Mikey and Mary entered the darkened room, where a shrunken and diminished Ethel, who was no longer the Merm, sat in a chair propped up by pillows. Mikey thought, this can't be her. This marionette without strings. It must be someone else, her mother perhaps. But he knew that Agnes Zimmerman had died a few years back. But then, who was this emaciated woman with the skinny legs and a face all puffed out as if she'd been inflated like a Macy's balloon version of Ethel? Who had made her up with redder than red lipstick and fake drawn-in eyebrows? Who had plopped that little red wig on top of her shaved head like a polyester cherry on top of a Halloween sundae? Ethel, you remember Michael. Ethel looked at Mikey and then at Mary and muttered out at the side of her mouth like a bussin' truck at Edward G. Robinson chomping on a stogie. I'm not fucking senile. Mikey almost laughed as Mary blushed as pink as the fake plastic roses near her bed. I brought you roses, but I forgot you're allergic to them. Ethel looked up at him with her ancient yet unlined face and sadly murmured, doesn't matter. No more singing. Mikey could feel his heart breaking inside him, but he was determined to keep a cheerful conversation going. He asked about the sign on her TV that forbade any channel changing. He mentioned that he had just been playing the 10-inch Decca record of the Ford 50th anniversary duet this morning and wondered why part of it was deleted on the record. Probably because of the lack of groove space on those old records, Mary chimed in. Through all the forced, idle chit-chat, Ethel just stared straight ahead. It must have been a strain for her to even try to talk out of one side of her mouth, the one side that still functioned. She looked like she might slide off the chair into a crumpled heap at any moment. You know what movie I got on VHS, Mikey? Was pulling at straws. Strike Me Pink. It's from 1936 and you co-star with Eddie Cantor, remember? He immediately felt stupid asking her if she remembered, but he went on anyway. I watched it last night for the first time since I was 12 and marveled again at that torch song you sang. I think it was by Harold Arlen. At Mikey's mention of this movie, he could see a glimmer of recognition in Ethel's eyes, a spark of something that wasn't there when he and Mary walked into the room. Before he could finish his sentence, and just as he mentioned Harold Arlen's name, the crisp, clear, and very loud sound of a much younger Ethel Merman came out of her suddenly straightened mouth. First you have me high, then you have me low. The woman in the polyester wig and painted eyebrows, whose brain tumor had brought on a stroke that slurred her speech and gnarled her mouth, sang like it was 1936. Mary Martin's mouth fell open. Why, Ethel, you can sing. Even Ethel was shocked by the outpouring of sound coming out of her fully formed lips, so shocked that her painted on eyebrows went up another inch. She sang those two lines of the song with such Merman-esque power that her maid came running into the room seeing why the TV was on so loud. What she found was a miracle out of a fairy tale. But as quickly as the miracle had occurred, it was over. Ethel's painted eyebrows returned to their usual abnormal place on her face, and her mouth laid back on its side, as if it could do nothing more than lounge on a divan, like an overly made-up Mae West. Mikey and the Marys watched as a single tear made its way down Ethel's round cheek. That's it, Mary Two decreed as she turned off the TV that played night and day. Miss M needs her rest, and this has been a more than full day. Michael Minkus and Mary Martin both got up and gave Ethel a peck on her cheek. I'll see you soon, Mighty Merm, Mary Martin whispered in Ethel's ear. You keep on going on. Goodbye, said Mikey. Merman stared straight ahead at the TV screen as the door shut, leaving her alone with her face illuminated by the glow of the Motorola TV. She never sang again. The story does end happy. That story I wanted to read to you because that really happened. I was there that day when the miracle occurred. I told her I saw her on that TV show and she opened up the mouth that was like this and sang out. And I realized, you know, there's a different part of the brain that works for singing. Yeah. And it really worked for her. And so I always remember that and I saved it for the book. And in the end, Mikey gets out of his mother's basement and the bags are packed and he starts to live his life. Thank you. Okay. Any other questions? No.
Was the brain tumor correct?
That was correct. That really happened. It was I was with her. Okay, I was with her the night before she was felled by the stroke, which was the brain tumor. And that night she showed me the costume design that Bob Mackie made for her. She was to appear on the Oscars a month later. She was going to fly the next morning. That next morning, she had the stroke and fell and never appeared on the Oscars. And I didn't even know about what had happened to her till I didn't see her on the Oscars.
Yeah, yeah.
And then found out, and it was an inoperable brain tumor. And she lived, that was from March to the next January. And so that's it, yeah. Sad, sad, sad. Mary lived, they both died at 76 years old. That's another coincidence. Mary lived another few years and also, and died of cancer. But boy, there's been nobody like them since.
No, really.
So the book is funny, the book is poignant. I think you'll enjoy it.